Harp Notes in the Mist. Years ago, I lived for a few months in the little town of Passe Christiane at a tavern called the Inn by the Sea. On hot nights that summer, just as the sun seemed to be dropping into the waters to the west, my host would ask us to come aboard his red-sailed sloop, and we would skim the rippling surface of the Gulf of Mexico for a few hours before returning to our beds. Among those who sailed with us on those evenings were gentlemen who had been born in Passe Christiane, and sometimes as the moon climbed the sky, they would tell us a legend of the old town. They said that when their great-grandfathers were young, the whole populace was awakened on a foggy night by a strange reddish glare far out on the gulf. Voices called through the streets urging the young men to launch their boats and go to the rescue of a ship burning on the horizon. Out into the misty darkness, the boats sped, guided by the orange flames in the distance. As they neared their goal, the crews heard music drifting over the still black water. To their incredulous ears came the sound of harp notes, and a melody that one of the elder rowers recognized as an ancient Portuguese love song. It seemed to come from the very heart of the flames. When the leading boat was so near that those in it could hear the crackle of the racing fire, there was a sudden explosion and the ship went down, leaving only a few charred timbers floating on the water. The would-be rescuers circled about but found no survivors. Shocked by the tragedy, they returned to the shore, and there, to their surprise, they came upon a beached lifeboat in which the captain of the ship and four of his men had made their escape. The captain was a handsome young man, genial and charming, and he made so favorable an impression on the hospitable folk of Passe Christiane that they welcomed him to their homes, gave parties in his honor, and urged him to give up the sea and live among them. The captain told them that he was touched by their warm welcome, and before long he announced that he would accede to their entreaties. A month later, he bought a plantation of many acres. The windows of its pillared big house looked out upon the gulf. Here he lived in luxury, attended by the four men who had been his companions. It was said that he had paid for his new property in golden Brazilian coins. All went well with the captain for more than a year. He bought a number of slaves, and he gave such elaborate parties that he became the leading social figure of the aristocratic little town. Then a visitor from New Orleans arrived at one of the neighboring mansions and almost immediately died of yellow fever, which had been raging in his native city. Soon the dread disease was spreading over Passe Christiane, and among its many victims was one of the captain's four accomplices. The doctor who attended the unfortunate man found him out of his mind with fever and heard him confess a horrible crime. In his delirium, the man said that a Brazilian gentleman had shipped aboard the captain's vessel at a South American port, bringing with him his beautiful wife and his entire fortune, which had been converted into gold coins and packed in a stout wooden chest. The Brazilian had told the charming captain of the gold, and the latter had no sooner heard of it than he determined to acquire it. He selected the four men of his crew whom he most trusted and informed them of his purpose. They would murder the rich passenger, he said, and load the money chest into the one small boat aboard. Then, after setting fire to the ship, they would row to shore with their loot and leave the rest of the crew and their victim's wife to die in the flames. They had carried out their scheme on the foggy night when the people of Passe Christiane had seen the ship burning. The dying seaman said that as the captain and his accomplices rowed away from the blazing vessel, the wife of the murdered man, realizing her doom, had brought up from her cabin the harp with which she was accustomed to entertain her husband, and had played on it an old Portuguese ballad until the explosion had sent all on board to their deaths. After the death of his fever-stricken patient, the doctor realized that his report of words spoken in delirium could not be accepted as positive proof. But he told his friends what he had heard, and the captain suddenly found himself a marked man. He planned another elaborate party, and not one of his former friends accepted his invitation. Suspicious that his secret had been discovered, he decided to flee past Christiane at once with his stolen gold. He rose from his bed at midnight, and taking his spade and a lantern with him, he ran down to the shore to unearth the chest which he had buried beneath a gnarled old oak. Unaware that he was being constantly watched, the murderer did not realize that the doctor and his friends had seen the glimmer of the lamp and had crept secretly to a nearby cove to watch his movements. Descendants of the watchers on that night say that their grandfathers have told them that as the captain uncovered the chest, an orange light appeared on the horizon and increased until the whole night seemed to be tinged with it. Then suddenly they heard the creak of oarlocks and saw a ghastly crew of skeletons rowing in perfect rhythm towards the shore. In the stern sat a beautiful dark-eyed woman playing a strange and lovely melody on a golden harp. Apparently the captain saw this vision too, for he stood up quickly and then fell upon the ground. When the watchers reached him, the boat and its occupants had vanished, and the captain lay dead, his hands clutched convulsively about golden coins. This is why, so people who have lived long at Passe Christiane say, on foggy summer nights, those who look out to sea may sometimes behold a glare far out on the water and hear harp notes drifting through the mist.